Welcome to Questions for Christians. This is a TV show where an atheist and a Christian have a respectable and interesting conversation. And today, I'm the atheist. My name is Bernie Dehler, and my guest is Kent Hovind. He's a Young Earth Creationist and an evangelist for the Christian faith. I'll give you a little short overview of who I am for people who don't know who I am, and then I'll give Kent some time to give a short overview of who he is. I was raised as a Roman Catholic. After college time, after I graduated from college, I became an evangelical Christian. I graduated from Oregon Institute of Technology with a Bachelor's of Science in Engineering Technology in 1984. I've been working in the computer industry ever since and just retired actually just recently. While I was working in the computer industry, I went to a seminary. It's called Luther Rice Seminary in Lithuania, Georgia. It's a conservative Baptist one. I graduated in 2007, and then in 2009, I actually became an atheist. When I was a Christian, I used to preach the gospel on the internet and also on local TV, like I'm now doing for atheism, trying to spread the word about atheism. After I left the faith in 2009, that was after 25 years as a born-again evangelical Christian, I wrote a booklet called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. That's to help remind me why I left the faith and also to explain to other people when they ask me why did I leave the religion. Because I do believe that modern science and philosophy do destroy the Christian message. And we're going to talk about some of that in our show today. And I've done numerous local debates and discussions with Christians in this Portland area. And in fact, with my guest, Kent Hovind here, we've had him on a previous show. And his son, Eric Hovind, I've actually debated at Portland State University a few years back. And I'd just like to mention, too, that sometimes people say they know God exists because they have a relationship with God. They can feel him. I know that what they mean by that because I also felt like I had that relationship. But I now just believe it's a delusion, because I feel like I studied my way out of it. One last note is I just wanted to explain my shirt a little bit. It shows the evolutionary process, and at the very end here, we have a robot. So I believe that, you know, just as evolution, I think the evolution is a superior creation story to the Bible, where basically it talks about from the, according to the science, from the Big Bang, we have particles from the sun and creating other particles after they blow up in the supernova, creating planets, and then plant and animal life arose, and now we're going to have artificial intelligence. So it's kind of a playful way to show evolution, I think. But I consider that we may be on Earth for millions of years. Got a long time to go. Welcome to the show, Kent. I would like to give you some time. Feel free to tell the audience what kind of work do you do, what kind of books have you written, etc.
Well, thank you for having me. Yes, my name is Kent Hovind. I taught high school science and math for 15 years. Let's see, I've written about 55 books, I think. I never counted them, somewhere close to there. I teach on the subject of creation versus evolution. I take the position that the Bible is literally true and scientifically accurate. God made everything, stars, dinosaurs, man, everything in 6 days, six literal 24-hour days, about 6,000 years ago. The Earth is not billions of years old. Dinosaurs lived with man. They probably called them dragons in most cultures. And there's where we cover all that in my seminars. I travel and speak at churches and schools and universities. I do a lot of debates on the topic. I defend the position that the Bible is true, and the evolution theory is one of the dumbest and most dangerous religions in the history of humanity. It's not only dumb, it's dangerous. We teach the kids they're an animal and then wonder why they act like animals. And I mean, it's no marvel to me. So, yeah, I take the exact opposite position. I think not only is there a God, I know him personally. He's my friend. I talk to him all the time. Okay?
What are you up to? I know you got some kind of park going on. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that? You want to mention that?
Well, 70 miles straight north of Pensacola is a real tiny town in Alabama called Lenox, L-E-N-O-X. 1 mile north of Lenox is an old gravel pit, 150 acres that we just bought, someone bought for us. And we're developing Dinosaur Adventureland. We had one in Pensacola, a little Dinosaur Adventureland museum, science center, theme park, where everything had a science lesson and a spiritual application to that science lesson. But it was on 5 acres and been closed for years. This one's going to be the same thing, only on steroids, with teaching kids the science and how science backs up the Bible, exactly, and gives glory to God, as opposed to science being used to teach or support the evolution religion. We want Dinosaur Adventureland here to be a place for kids to come to learn about science and appreciate the God of the creation. So anyway, we're in the just early stages of construction, getting housing and a place for our ministry headquarters to come out of Pensacola. We just got a few people that work in our ministry and help us out, but we have probably 8 or 10 volunteers here that have come to do all the construction. So if you got a hammer, come on down. We'll put you to work.
Okay, Ken, I'd like to start with a compliment for you. Your YouTube channel is actually really quite popular. You have a really strong following. You got thousands of people watching your videos. And even in your Dinosaur Adventureland, which you're building up, I've seen some of your videos on that. You've got people donating large amounts of cash and land. And so you have a lot of dedicated followers. That's pretty impressive.
Well, maybe it's because we're right.
Do you think that's kind of a standout compared to other Christian ministries, or do you think it's like just like that's usual for Christian ministries?
Well, I don't know. I don't follow any other ministries. I don't know what's normal for them, but God leads. I think God called me to plow this row, and I'm plowing. I don't even look to see what other row other people are plowing.
Okay.
They can do whatever God tells them to do.
Okay, so we're going to get into our questions. We're trying to format the show for 5 questions and equal time, no sermons for either one of us, and just to show a dialogue and discussion. And each of these questions is hopefully about 10 minutes. So the first question is evolution as a religion, or we can say atheism as a religion. And the reason why I have this is because last time we talked, there were some of my atheist friends were upset with me because you said that atheism is a religion or even evolution is a religion, and that upsets a lot of atheists because they figure, you know, they want nothing to do with religion. So I thought we'd talk about that for a little bit. So yeah, I know you, is that a claim you like to throw out there, that evolution and atheism is a religion?
Oh, absolutely. Evolution. You have to define 2 words in that sentence. So what do you mean by evolution and what do you mean by religion? Standard dictionary definition of religion is a belief or belief system on how the world got here. Is kind of, you know, how, and there's many different religions in the world, obviously. how did we get here? So it's something you believe as opposed to science, which is testable, observable, demonstrable in a laboratory, for example. Evolution has 6 different meanings to the word. I cover this in my seminar, Part 4. You'd have to have cosmic evolution, the origin of time, space, matter. You'd have to have chemical evolution, the origin of all the chemicals. Then you'd have to have stellar evolution. All the stars would have to evolve. You'd have to have organic evolution. Life would have to start from non-living material. You'd have to have macroevolution, where this life form changed to different kinds of life. And then you have microevolution, which is changes within the kind, like dogs and wolves probably have a common ancestor. Only number 6 on that list, microevolution, is actually science. All the other 5 are religious. So when I use the word evolution, I am not referring to minor variations within the same kind. Darwin wrote a book called The Origin of Species. The argument is really not about speciation. It's about kinds. Where do the kinds come from? There are 900 species of bats in the world. They probably had a common ancestor.
Well, okay, before you go off on another topic, how about we'll address what you've said already?
So okay, sure.
How many different types of evolution did you say there were? 6?
I put it in 6 okay. Different sections, totally unrelated categories.
Okay, so of all those kinds of evolution, which one do you think is the least scientific or the most religious? Which one is, basically, which one is your best case for your argument, you think?
I think all 5 of the top 5 are purely religious. No one has ever seen a dog produce a non-dog.
But
so
why
that
would
be in the...
But why would they? But why would you expect that? Because according to the theory of evolution, you wouldn't expect to see that.
Well, do you believe dogs came from something ultimately that was non-dog? If you go back long enough, far enough ago in time.
Sure. Like even humans came from fish and other animals before that.
Well, and that you're welcome to believe that, but that's my point. That's a religious belief. That's not scientifically observable. We have humans having babies all the time, and they're always human.
Well,
dogs
of course,
have puppies all the time, and they're always dogs.
Well, but yeah, but according to the theory of evolution, you wouldn't expect it to be observable. So that can't be a mark against it if you can't observe it.
Well, my point is, then it's not typical science. Look up the definition of science. Science, from the Latin word "seer," to know. Things that we know by observation, testing, experimentation. Can you do some observation to see an animal produce a different kind?
No, but
why would you believe?
Well, you
believe
don't. You don't always have to directly see things. I mean, deductive logic plays a really big role in it. I mean, for example, you can't see your fingernails growing, but we know they grow with logic.
Well, actually, you could see them grow. You could document that example. You cannot see or document dogs coming from non-dogs, or dogs and bananas having a common ancestor.
But
nobody documents that.
But you can't see your fingernails growing; they grow too slow.
Well, I could take a picture every day of my fingernails, and in probably 3 months it grows from cuticle to cutting length, as typical for your fingernails, and about 6 months for the toenail.
But what if somebody said that's just one theory? Actually, what happens is every hour God makes it just pop out another small millimeter or whatever.
Well, this is where you have to first define what you mean by science. And so I think the standard definition in any dictionary is going to be seer, to know. What do we know by observation, experimentation, and testing?
Mm-hmm.
You don't know that dogs came from a common ancestor with tomatoes. You can believe that, but nobody knows that. You can't know such a thing. That's purely religious, which is my point.
But I mean, personally, for me, I know there's a pseudogene argument, and that alone, when you look at the genomes or the DNA sequences across different species, and you see what happens across species, to me alone, that is enough evidence. And then there's also other evidence in the DNA, like fused human chromosome number 2. And to me, those are overwhelming evidence. So, maybe when you say you don't know it, maybe it's because you don't know what the biologists know. Maybe the knowing is on your part for not being educated in modern biology.
Well, certainly I'm willing to listen to that. I did teach high school biology 15 years, but as far as pseudogenes, what you're doing is you're looking at one gene in the human gene code. One gene is more complex than any computer program ever written by Microsoft, ever.
I don't think that's appropriate to compare a gene to computer code.
It's an illustration to help people understand. The computer code is a list of instructions to tell the computer what to do. The genes are a list of instructions to tell the cell what to do.
How to metabolize, how to grow, how to reproduce. Sure, but the biological code is nothing like computer code. I mean, the ATCG and the DNA, the way it codes like codons for amino acids, the way that's a coding, there's no parallel to that in computer science.
Well, yeah, there is. See, the computer is just binary code, 1, 0, whereas the CATG is 4. By using 4 base pairs, it gives it trillions of times more complexity available in the gene code, which was my point. The single gene is more complicated than any computer program written by Microsoft or anybody else or Apple.
But let's say if you take a gene, like the gene for eye color, there is actually no such thing as one gene. Every gene, there's like what they call a gene pool. There's every gene is a little bit different, and there's a high probability of certain genes. That's why you can say this gene pool has mostly blue-eyed or whatever. But then when you look across species, you can see how those bits in the DNA code change a little bit.
I agree. I think if I looked at all the lines of code for Microsoft PowerPoint and compared it to the lines of code for Microsoft Word, we would find thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of identical lines of code. Probably they both go to the same spell check database. Okay, what's that proof of? That's proof they got the same designer. If there are similar codes between our DNA and a chimpanzee DNA and a tomato DNA, it doesn't prove a common ancestor. It proves a common designer of the code.
The problem is with comparing it there, I mean, the code for Microsoft, for example, is specific code. It doesn't change ever by one little bit, like one. You can change the DNA code by many bits and have the same exact amino acid sequence because there's so much redundancy in the codon pairing, the codon to amino acid. There are multiple ways to code the same exact amino acid. So if you change one bit, there's absolutely no change whatsoever in the amino acid, which means the code can change, and that's the way our code is in our body. They're all a little bit different, and sometimes they have the exact same amino acids, but the programs are nothing like that. Program is exactly ones and zeros, and they're exactly there's exact right. code. They don't change little bits here and there.
But you're missing the point. The complexity of the human genome is many orders of magnitude beyond the simple ones and zeros of binary code for computers, and that is evidence of an intelligent designer.
I don't know if that's I don't know if that's fair to say, because that's hard to measure complexity, because we have computer code that can do things that humans can't do at all. I mean, like, supercomputers can blow away humans on certain calculations and things. Like, they can simulate a nuclear weapon blowing up. I mean, so what do you mean by complexity?
So
I mean, it's a difficult argument to make, because they're just apples and oranges, it seems like.
That's why you have to define the terms. That's what I've been trying to do. Science is things we can observe, study, test, demonstrate. We don't observe dogs produce non-dogs ever. Every farmer in the world counts on evolution not happening. He crosses his cows, he expects a calf. You know, he plants corn, he expects corn. Now, there may be varieties of corn, like I don't know how many hundred varieties there are, but they're still corn, and they're recognizable as corn. There's varieties of dogs, Chihuahuas to Great Danes, but the variations within any of the kinds have limits. And the further you get away from the norm, the more problems you're going to have. Like, for instance, cows that give 100 pounds of milk a day. Yeah, but you got to babysit the dumb thing. It would never survive in the wild. So you can selectively breed for more milk production, but you're going to lose in something else, in viability. So what we observe is cows produce cows, dogs produce dogs. There simply are no exceptions in known history.
Okay.
So if you want to believe, I think your choice is to believe that cows and bananas are related. That is a religion in every sense of the word. It's something you believe in. Maybe you believe it very strongly. I don't question that. But the point is, it's not science. Evolution is not science. It's nonsense, in my opinion. But it's certainly not science. It's a religious belief.
Okay. Let me summarize with a dictionary definition here, and then I'll give you a chance to some rebuttal if you want to. But so on a dictionary definition I got up online here from the Oxford English Dictionary. It says, religion, number one, the belief in and worship of a superhuman controlling power, especially a personal god or gods. For example, in the sentence, ideas about the relationship between science and religion. 1.1 is a particular system of faith and worship. For example, saying the world's great religions. And then another definition, 1.2, a pursuit of interest to which someone describes supreme importance. For example, consumerism is the new religion. So from my perspective, I could see how religion could be used in either way. I understand totally if an atheist says, do not call this a religion because I do not believe in God and I think it's all fairy tale. And so I can see that point. And I could also see the point where you can say it's a religion because it's something that somebody deeply believes. And so to me, I don't really care about the whole thing. So, but I wanted to throw that in there. So how about some closing comments for you, and then we'll move on to the next one.
Well, there's no question the evolutionists deeply believe that cows and tomatoes are related. They believe it. They really do believe it. I don't question that. And they're constantly looking for evidence to support their belief, which is normal for every religion to do, to look for evidence to support their belief. But it's not science, and it should not be taught in public school textbooks at public taxpayer expense. Evolution should only be taught in private schools where people want to pay and come learn it. As it is now, we're forcing everybody to pay to have one religion taught in the school system. It's completely unfair, unconstitutional, immoral, in my humble, totally unbiased opinion.
Okay. Can we go on to the next one now? Next subject?
Sure, sure.
Okay, so this next topic is the gospel nonsense? I guess I'll start off with saying that, I mean, to me, the whole gospel seems like nonsense, because basically God made us, and then we are sinners, and then he basically is upset with us, or is God's wrath on us, and so basically you can say he killed himself to appease his own wrath, because Jesus is God's son and there's only one God. And then we're talking about a immortal God who's dying. What is that supposed to mean? How can something that's immortal die and then come back to life? And then it seems like this is not even justice. How could it be justice to kill somebody for somebody else's sin, And also, this sounds like child sacrifice. That's supposed to be a gross thing according to the Old Testament. So why is it a good thing in the New Testament? So those are just...
Well, there's five or six questions in one there. Which one do you want to discuss?
Whichever one you want to. Which one do you... Well, let me start with child sacrifice. Is it that child sacrifice?
Well, there's all kinds of ways to look at that, I suppose. If you had a dreaded disease and were going to die and needed a transplant of, say, I don't know, a liver or something, and I chose to give my liver to save your life, is that sacrifice or is that compassion? Is it because of I love? A just God has to punish every single sin. If God allowed you or I into heaven, into his kingdom, as we are in our natural state, we would quickly turn heaven into like it is on earth, which is a pretty unsafe place to live most of the time. A lot of bad things happening down here, and we're not going to have that in heaven. So God in his wisdom decided nobody comes here unless they're perfect. And since none of us are perfect, we're all doomed to miss it. But God in his justice, he has to condemn us. But in his mercy and love, he provided another way. He said, I myself am perfect. I will come down and I will pay your punishment on myself on the cross. And so that's what he came to do, and I believe that. I can't prove that. That's why Christianity is a religion, and we admit ours is a religion.
How does God killing himself solve anything? I mean, why can't he just say, I forgive everybody? Why does blood have to come into this?
Yeah, that's a good question. There have been many theologians who pondered that over the centuries. I'm sure somebody's written some books on that, but I don't know. I can just say that's what the Bible says. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission.
Isn't the answer obvious? It's because basically it's fulfillment of the Old Testament, and that's what Moses set up. And then the question is, why would Moses do it? And it's just because, well, there was an ancient idea that if things are bad, the gods are angry with us, so we have to sacrifice an animal or a firstborn or something. You know, in the Old Testament, it talks about Molech, and they used to sacrifice kids, and God even says in Jeremiah, I believe, that, you know, this is detestable, something I never even thought of, and yet here in the New Testament, it's like, I'm sending my son. It's like...
Well, I think you're looking at it a different way than I would look at it. When Adam and Eve sinned and disobeyed God, they made themselves, you know, aprons of fig leaves. God killed something. We assume an innocent lamb, but we don't know that. But he killed, let's say he killed a lamb and made them coats of skins. We started from the very beginning, God's teaching them that the wages of sin, the cost of sin is very high. Something has to die. Only a sacrifice will satisfy God. Now, why? I don't know. Take that up with God. But I'm just telling you, that's what he said in his book, and I believe that. And Jesus Christ was God himself in the flesh and came down to be the ultimate sacrifice, and I'm very grateful for that.
Okay.
And he promised those that receive him, he changes them on the inside. I became a new man 47 years ago when I received Christ as my Savior.
Okay. So many questions on this. So like in the Bible, it talks about in the garden, Jesus was, you know, fretting about doing this, and he was so anxious about it that he was sweating blood and he decided to do it. So it kind of makes it sound like he had a choice about whether he wanted to do it or not, right?
And that's another great deep theological question. I would assume that is correct, but I don't.
Yeah, and the thing I'm trying to figure out is how could it be a choice? Because if he's supposed to be God and he knows the future and this was done by the foundation of the world, how he already knows what's going to happen. And then, if he could make his mind up and say, okay, I'm not going to do it after all, well, what situation do you have here? Now you have a God-man who says, I'm not going to do what I was going to do, but he's still going to go to heaven because he's God?
Yeah, those are deep, as I said, deep theological questions. You better ask a theologian. I'm just a high school science teacher defending the biblical view of creation. I can't answer all those questions of why. I'm just telling you that's what he said in his book that he did. And just because we don't understand doesn't mean there isn't an answer. It just means I currently don't have it. And I certainly wouldn't reject the rest of the creation story based on something I don't understand. There are many things about automobiles I do not understand. But I drive one anyway. I don't have to understand it all. I do it, you know.
Well, the other thing
this happens.
Okay, well, how about this question, too? So if Jesus died on the cross, what does that mean to say he died? Because, you know, God can't die if he's immortal. So what is that supposed to mean?
That's another great theological question. Sounds like you've been around the bush on this one. Well, there's several different types of death. There's physical death. Usually people define death to mean separation. Physical death is separation of the soul and spirit from the body. Spiritual death is separation from God. Eternal death would be separation from God eternally in hell. Those seem to be the three different types of death talked about in the Bible. Physical death is one we're most familiar with, but the Bible says we're spiritually dead. We're separated from God because of our sin, and Jesus Christ is the mediator, the go-between, the attorney to bring us together again.
Jesus, the Son of God, was separated by God the Father. They were separated, so they're both God and they're separate.
Great. Well, I guess you can look at yourself and say, you know, you can say, you can talk to yourself, you can think about things, but you can also think about what you're thinking about to determine if that's a good thought or a bad thought.
Mm-hmm.
So is there more than one brain in your head? No, your brain has different functions, is one way to look at it. You can think about them. Plus, my brain is not only thinking of things and thinking about what it is thinking about to determine if it's moral or just. I'm also doing subconscious things, like keeping my heart rate monitored, my temperature, my posture, various healing mechanisms. I don't even think about those things. But it's just one brain doing all of that. That's just a crude analogy of how it is possible for one person to have multiple functions. I am a dad. I am a husband. I am a grandfather. I am a brother. I am a neighbor. I'm just one person. I have multiple functions. Probably every analogy we give about God breaks down at some point, but those are just a few examples of how it is certainly possible for God to have multiple functions at the same time, be the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That's what he claims.
Okay. Shall we move on to the next one then?
Sure, sure.
Okay. This one actually is, it's interesting that you brought up this, the brain thing, because this is going to come into this question, I think, actually. The question is, like, this is kind of a statement I'll make, is that the resurrection only makes sense if the supernatural soul exists. And personally, I don't believe there's a supernatural soul. I think all we have is the mind that emerges from the brain. And I think there's some problems for people who posit the idea that there is a supernatural soul. And I'll list three of those and get your response. One of them is what you already brought up, where let's talk about a split brain patient. They have, actually on YouTube, there's a funny story of a doctor who talks about there's this cord, basically, a communication channel between the left and right hemisphere, and they sometimes snip that in epileptic patients so they don't have a seizure. It stops it from spreading from one part of the brain to the other part of the brain. And when they do this, they have a person with a split left-right brain. They no longer communicate. And they could actually ask each part of the brain if they believe in God. And one person, part of the brain said yes, and the other part said no. So the funny question was, is this person going to heaven or hell? Because part of his brain believes and the other doesn't. If you think there's a supernatural soul involved in that, that's a complication there.
Do you believe that your brain, the brain of Bernie, is a result of random collection of chemicals over billions of years?
Not so much. There are some random aspects, but it's not 100% random. Like, for example, animals do migration and mating dances and stuff, so there is some stuff they do that are non-random. But
certainly you would say, I would assume, being an atheist, that you would say your brain was not designed necessarily by a designer. It's just it has accumulated these traits over X number of billion years.
Years. Designed by a mindless nature, yes.
Well, then how can you trust your own thoughts and any conclusions you come to?
Well, that's why we invented the scientific method.
How do you know the scientific method is right? How can you know anything?
It's very easy because of the results of it. That's why they invented things on the scientific method, such as independent observation, because one person might be deluded, so you have to independently verify it. That's why we have placebo testing to make sure it's not a placebo, it's a real effect. That's why we have double-blind testing, because we know the doctor giving the test can subjectively influence it. So basically we're trying to remove all these subjective errors out.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the different testing techniques and all that.
That's why we like logic and science, is because it's been proven. That the proof is in the pudding, basically.
Well, what proof is there then that any animal can come can change to a different kind of animal? And I use the word kind, not species. We see variations in the dog family from Great Dane to Chihuahua, but everybody will tell you the variations are limited. You'll never get a dog as big as Texas. There's a limit someplace. Now, whether the Great Dane is the biggest or not, I don't know. Probably close. And you won't get a Chihuahua might be the limit, or the toy Chihuahua, whatever, but you're not going to get one as small as a flea or a molecule. There's a limit to the variations, and the variations are still recognizable as the same kind of animal. So there's no observation. It's not logical to say it goes anything beyond that.
Well, I believe that there is so much evidence for evolution in the DNA. It's overwhelming. I feel like I see the evidence for it.
Well, give me an example. Evidence in the DNA. That's like saying I see evidence for evolution in the Microsoft code, because you know these six lines of code from PowerPoint match these six lines from Word.
Well, there is a sort of evolution in Microsoft code. It's called mimetic evolution, which is the evolution of ideas. You know, for example, cars weren't just created from scratch. They did have precursors in railroad cars and even horse and buggy and things like that, the wheel and all that.
Right, but that came because of an intelligent person thinking of some way to fix it or improve it. You're wanting the same improvement without any intelligent being, i.e. without God.
Well, I believe in the DNA. There's like there. You can see the bits change. It's a Christian who's a biologist at Trinity. I think it's called Trinity University. He's a practicing biologist, and he gave a lecture on there and over the evidence for evolution. And he's an evangelical Christian that fully accepts evolution, and he's trying to teach other Christians all this evidence. And I find it overwhelming myself. So
well, it accepts evolution. Again, what do you mean by evolution? Microevolution?
No, I'm talking. I'm talking about macro. That basically he's comparing the gene sequences across many different animals, like humans, dogs, fish.
Well, I don't think you realize that you've just proven my point. If he accepts evolution, then it's something he believes, and he accepts it as a belief system. It's a religion. Why doesn't he demonstrate it? Show me how fish and dogs are related. I'd like to see them happen. I'd like to see those cross mate and make something.
Well, they can't mate because they're different species. So, but, you know, according to evolution, they're not expected to mate.
The Bible says they bring forth after their kind. You know, any exceptions to that ever in the history of humanity?
Well, what about, a funny question there then, what about like the platypus? I mean, what kind of a kind is that? That thing, you know, because that's supposed to be the funniest creature ever, because it's like a mammal that lays eggs, which is not really what a mammal does, and it's got a beak, and you know, it's such a hodgepodge. It's a really funny creature. Is that supposed to be a kind?
Yeah, I think the platypus is a kind all of its own, and when platypus mate, they produce platypus without exception. And the fact that it has unusual traits and we can't put it into our classification system neatly, in our little cubbyhole system of mammals and fish, etc. That doesn't prove anything on creation or evolution. It just proves our classification system is limited. Like there's two-wheel vehicles and four-wheel vehicles and three-wheel vehicles. What if somebody makes a five-wheel or a 20-wheel? Where are we going to categorize it? Who says we have to categorize it? The platypus does seem to be a very unique individual animal. Okay. But they crossbreed and they do produce more platypus. And there are no exceptions to that. None. So someone can believe that's evidence for evolution if they want. But I think it's a pretty cool animal. And apparently, they like each other. I don't know.
Well,
they get along.
Well, going back to this problem about the soul, I was saying the resurrection only makes sense if there is a supernatural soul, and we probably agree that if there was no supernatural soul, the gospel story doesn't make sense. It's just that you believe in a supernatural soul, right?
Right. I think there's more to man than just a body and just a electrical impulses in the brain.
Okay, so let me bring up two interesting cases. Sometimes people say, as Christians say, that like at the time of conception that a soul comes into the sperm and the egg after it joins together. Two interesting cases. One is identical twins. What happens there is a sperm and the egg, they meet and they make an organism, the human starting, and it splits, from 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 cells. And at some point, the whole mass splits off into two. So where there was one individual, now there's two individuals. And so the question is, if there is a soul on that one individual, what does God do? Does he give the second one a soul now, or was there two to begin with, two souls in one person, and they each took one? And then the other one is, the other case is there's a chimera where it's the opposite case where a woman could have two fertilized eggs growing. And then, so there's two basically humans in her womb, and at some point they merge together. It's called a chimera. And so the question there is, well, when they merge, does that thing now have two souls, or did one just die, or which one would die? How does that work? Those are questions.
It was your premise that the soul comes in at conception. I don't know. I think life starts at conception. Now, whether that's the soul or not, I don't know. What is exactly the difference between the soul and the spirit? The Bible talks about in Hebrews 4:12, I believe, about the separating of the body, soul, and spirit. I think man is certainly more than just a body. We could classify plants as living, but only having a body. Animals as living, but also having a consciousness of life that plants don't seem to have. There's something different about animals from plants. And then man would have a body, a consciousness of life, and a consciousness of a higher creator, a God. Nearly all religions of the world, all people groups of the world have some form of religion, a consciousness that there's a higher power. And so that's the point, that there's more to man than just the body or the mind. We're not just animated meat. If we are, by your definition of what humans are, how do you tell right from wrong on any topic?
Well,
I don't think that's right or wrong.
I mean, I have a totally different understanding of what morality is than you do. I mean, I guess you must think morality is just what God says is right and wrong. You don't figure it out for yourself, right?
Well, if every man figures it out for himself, then Saddam Hussein was going around killing people. He's perfectly fine.
Well, in a way, everybody does figure it out for themselves. Your choice was just to lean on God or the Bible. Somebody else might lean on the Quran. Somebody else might lean on the Book of Mormon, and somebody else Hindu scriptures. So in a way, you are making your own choice just to use the Bible.
Sure, which one is right? Was Hitler right to do what he did?
Well, okay, we're far afield now, but I could just give a quick answer. Basically, the way I see it is, morality is all about behavior, and it comes down to what's good and bad, and good is about flourishing society, and bad is what hurts society. I believe there is a Nazi morality. There is a Christian morality. I have a natural philosophical morality. I believe my morality is superior to your Christian morality and the Nazi morality. And if you want to ask why, we would have to talk about principles. What principles do I use? And I use like consequentialism, reciprocity, individual free rights. And why do I choose those? Because they lead to a better society. So, I mean, to me, it's all pretty logical. It's not like God said it, so I believe it kind of thing.
Well, Hitler certainly wanted a better society. Mm-hmm. Eliminate the inferiors, the unfit, the mentally deficient, the mentally physically crippled. I mean, blonde-haired, blue-eyed, they're the supreme. Hey, I'm blonde-haired, blue-eyed. I don't know. Are you Bernie? Are you blonde-haired, blue-eyed?
No, not blonde-haired.
You should go ahead and kill yourself then. Let people like me take over the world.
Well, so you're a blondie, okay.
Oh, yeah, blonde, blue-eyed, natural, too, see?
Okay, well, I can't argue against that. Yeah, I mean.
Okay.
So you don't know when the spirit comes into a person then? I mean, could it be at 10 weeks, 20 weeks when they're born, or you have no idea, or don't care, or what?
I don't know when that happens. And I think, but your premise was that because a woman can have a chimera, you know, two eggs that merge, or identical twins where, you know, same cell mass splits, your premise was that if the spirit soul began at conception, then therefore we have a problem. Mm-hmm. And I said, I don't know that we have a problem. I don't know the answer to that. But I think you are creating the problem by your premise.
Well, there's a lot of Christians going around. That's why they're so opposed to abortion, because it's like, oh my gosh, as soon as the sperm and the egg meet, there's some kind of magical moment there, and there's a soul there, and now you're killing a soul.
Well, I know. I said I think you're killing a life. Life begins at conception.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the soul, I don't know. Good question.
Okay. Next question. Ready to move on?
Sure.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
Let's see. This one is Genesis literally true with the talking serpent, the forbidden fruit, literally true? You always like to say, evolutionists, atheists, they believe that humans came from dirt or from a rock or something, right? But
that's ultimately what the evolution theory teaches. Yeah, we came from a rock 4.6 billion years ago.
But and you realize when you're saying that you're skipping all the intermediate steps, right? I mean, humans did not come directly from a rock. They came from other animals, which life arose from non-life, et cetera, right?
Well, my van did not come from a rock directly. I mean, somebody had to mine the iron ore and smelt it down and separate it and add the carbon. Okay. And, you know, but it happened because of intelligence. Some intelligent people took the parts and made the parts and put it together and made it run. To say that because the van is all natural products, which it is, therefore it made itself, is ridiculous. Because man is all natural components made from the 92 elements of the earth, I agree. But it shows evidence of design and a mastermind working on those components.
So you're saying that atheists believe that humans came from a rock, and you also believe that humans came from dirt, literally, right?
With a designer, not without a designer. That's the vast difference, any more than saying my van came from the iron mine, which is true, but it didn't come out of the iron by itself.
So when the Genesis, it says God basically scooped up dirt, made the shape of a human out of it, and then breathed into it to give it life, you think that's literally how it actually happened?
Oh, absolutely, I do. Can a person, you do computer work, right?
Yeah.
Can a person design bits, you know, ones and zeros, in which is simply electrical impulses, can he put them in a certain sequence and cause it to do something? Create an action, a reaction from this series of zeros and ones, the binary code. Sure he can. It's an evidence of intelligence. And so for God to make man out of the dust is amazing. We are made from the dust of the ground. I mean, I think everybody would agree that there's every component in the human body is some combination of some of those 92 elements, naturally occurring elements.
But wait a second. Don't you believe... You're just talking about like a programmer doing engineering, but that's not what you're thinking God did. I mean, aren't you literally thinking God took dirt and basically formed it in a human by just putting dirt, just packing it together, and then brought it to life by breathing into it literally? There's no programming. There's just, it's magic, basically. He brought it in because of his God's power, God's miracle.
Well,
there's no programming or anything there.
Yeah, the specifics of how he did it, I don't know, but obviously we do have an incredibly complicated code, a program. DNA is a computer program way beyond anything man's ever made.
But there's
just the DNA in your body.
But there's no mention of anything like that at all in the Genesis story. So I'm really confused as far as you saying you take it literally, but then you're saying, I don't understand, how did God do all that programming and everything if you just put dirt together?
He just spoke all the stars and the earth into existence. He didn't touch a thing. Why he chose to touch man and do something, form him, I don't know. I guess it shows we're special. But
okay.
He spoke everything else into, just his word made everything else.
Mm-hmm. So like a lot of magicians sometimes, you know, sometimes people call it incantation. They'll give an incantation like abracadabra and then poof, it happens. And so...
Right. So
if somebody says, like, well, what you're doing is just talking about magical thinking where God just says poof and it happens, does that seem like a legitimate criticism, or are you saying, yeah, that's God's magic, basically?
Well, if you want to use that terminology, I guess that's your choice of words, but the Bible says God did it, and I believe that. Is it just magic for a person to take a blank DVD and rearrange the code, or DVDs are a bad example? Rearrange the code on there just by rearranging the magnetic impulses, and now it carries a message. You can put a message like a song or a movie or something on a piece of plastic by arranging those ones and zeros.
Right, but there's nothing.
Yeah.
But there's nothing supernatural in there. Whereas, like when Jesus changes water into wine, there is no way logically that could happen because there's so many processes to go to grow grapes and press them and age it and all that stuff, and here Jesus did it in one, you know, waving his hand or whatever he did over it.
Well, yeah, that's what he said he did. I believe that. Now, that sure beats the theory of evolution, which says all this same stuff happened with nobody doing that, nobody touching it, nobody designing it, just blind chance. you're the one that's got the wild religion, in my opinion, to believe that there is no God to do this. Like if I showed you, if you're walking along the beach and you find a computer or a cell phone washed up on the beach, and I said, who made it? And you said, well, nobody. I found it on the beach. Well, it's too complicated. Waves don't do that with silicone on the beach.
But one of the, so one of the common complaints on that is that when you say you find a watch or something, you're talking about finding things that we know that humans created. And when you look at the DNA, this is not something that humans created. I mean...
But Bernie, if the DNA is a billion times more complicated than the watch, then it's common sense 101 to say, if the watch was created, the human who found it must have been created.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's fair to say it's more complicated. I mean, if you want to, you can make a, you know, somebody could probably make an argument that a snowflake is so complicated. You could just put a microscope on it and look how intricate the patterns are and all this. It's hard to say. I mean, working in computers, I know how powerful computers are, and computers can do things that people can't. So, I mean, it's like apples and oranges. There's a different kind of complication.
Okay, well, would you agree that...
For example, some people say the human brain is the most complex thing in all the universe. I don't know if you can say that. Supercomputers are, in some ways, much more complicated than a brain. It depends on what the function, what they're trying to do. I mean, if you want to drive a car right now, I'd rather have a brain, but if you want to simulate a nuclear explosion, I'd much rather have a supercomputer. I mean, you can't do that. A supercomputer can do things in hours or days that a human would take a billion years to do by hand and still mess up.
Well, unless you look at the fact that you can imagine an atomic explosion in a matter of a microsecond.
But you couldn't simulate it and find out the exact, you know, what would exactly happen, which this is what they're doing with simulations. They're getting exact results without doing it in real life because of their calculation power. You know, like working in the computers, the amazing thing is working on these advanced computer chips, we actually simulate computer chips before they're built. They actually get the bugs out of the design code before it's actually even built. That's how well they can simulate them because they know what the process technology is like, and it's kind of mind-boggling, the computational capabilities.
Well, and there's nobody with half a brain and one eye that would think the computer happened by chance, and yet they think the human cell happened by chance or a blade of grass happened by chance, which is able to reproduce itself, which adds billion more levels of complexity.
Yeah, but like I said, we know what humans can make, though, and it just seems like it's apples and oranges comparing biology to man-made devices.
Okay, well, I think it's a fair analogy.
You know, the fascinating thing there, too, is, you know, with human DNA engineering, like with this CRISPR thing, they're starting to modify the DNA code, so it'll only be a few more years where they could actually create things with DNA, and it's going to be interesting to see what actually creatures are going to develop. And they'll probably do it much more efficiently, like have smaller genomes because there's less waste and everything in them. So that's going to be an interesting...
Or they might create something for which there is... it creates a bigger problem, like bringing kudzu vine to the United States. We've got them growing every place now, or, you know, feral animals that should not be in a certain place because they have no natural enemy, like the starlings brought to America. So maybe it's what science... I mean, you have great dreams and visions of it improving things. Maybe it's going to make it worse.
Okay. One last question on this. Somebody said, you know, it was interesting how in the Bible, the devil in the Old Testament, he's just a talking serpent. He's got no power, really, you know, in the Genesis. He doesn't really do much. But by the time you get to the New Testament, this devil is everywhere tempting everybody. It's like, how did the devil get so escalated up there, like godlike powers from the Old Testament to the New Testament?
I never thought about that one. That's a good question. Maybe he had those powers all along. The Bible says in Ezekiel 28 that he was the anointed cherub that covereth. He was very proud of his wisdom, his beauty, his power. That's another whole theological study, I guess, someone could do on Satan and the origin and who is this guy, what's he like. And he certainly was created. He's part of the ordinary creation. He's not God. And we're going to marvel one day when we see him cast into hell. We're going to say, this is the guy that did all this trouble. I always think of the Wizard of Oz movie when they pulled the curtain back, like, this is the guy pulling the mirrors and smoking mirrors, and that's it. That's what we're going to say when we see Satan, I think. But
it's kind of interesting. In Genesis verse 3:1, it's kind of interesting how it says Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? So the way it's presented, it sounds like it says, now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord had made. So it kind of like puts him on the level of an animal and doesn't say like he's in heaven or, you know, going around tempting people or anything.
Well, it says he's more subtle, more crafty than, more subtle than all the creatures, all the other animals. So I guess that would put him on a different level, not the same level.
Okay. I guess we have an interpretation difference there. Last question. We don't have much time on this one, so just a few minutes. But I was listening to one of your videos, and you were talking about Catholicism, and I thought it'd be an interesting question to bring up. Because I was raised actually a Catholic, and then I became a born-again evangelical Christian after college. And I, when I was an evangelical Christian, I know there's a lot of people, probably like yourself, a lot of Christians, they don't consider Catholics as real Christians. And I'm kind of curious how you think about that, because like if you look at the worldwide Christians, I saw one poll here where 50% are Catholic. And so what does that mean to have a religion or a faith where like half the people, you know, are being led astray? You know, it's like, what's God doing here?
Well, I look at, there's only two religions in the world, Cain and Abel. Cain brought his fruit, his vegetables. Hey, God, look what I did for you. And you better take me, you better accept me. And God wouldn't do it. Abel brought an innocent substitute, a lamb, and God accepted it. The Catholics are very strongly in the Cain category. They're trying very hard to please God, just like Cain was really sincerely trying to please God by bringing his fruit and his vegetables. But that's not how you approach God. He didn't approach him right. You come with a sacrifice. That's just what it says. And so the do and the done, I guess, is the best, simplest way to put it. Is going to heaven something based on something you do or based on something that is done for you by someone else, i.e. Jesus Christ? You got a gift of life, Bernie. I don't know how old you are, but at some point you got a gift of life. Your parents gave you that gift. You had absolutely nothing to do with arriving on planet Earth. Zero, nada, zip, nothing. They did the work, went through the pain, and paid the bills. And you got a free gift out of the deal, life. Getting into God's family is the same way. Eternal life is a gift of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Not at all because of what we do. And so the Catholics, I would put them in the Cain category. They're saying, hey, God, look what I did for you. I said the sacraments. I said Hail Mary. I genuflect. I did all these things. You know, they're missing the point. They have a list of things to do to please God. The Muslims also have a list. Now, what's on the list is different, but the fact that they have a list is the problem. They're trying to please God with their works instead of just simple faith in a substitute. So to me, there's only two religions in the world. That would include not just Christian religions, but the Muslim, the all religions. They fall into the, how do you please God?
But is there something, is there something inconsistent or troubling to you that, you know, let's say Jesus came to Earth and he brought a message, and 2,000 years later, more than half the people that claim allegiance to that person are doing the wrong thing. And then, you know, even if you said all evangelicals are correct, I mean, there's only like 36% Protestant. There's still the Orthodox, another 12%. So it's like the people who you might consider the right ones are a minority.
I know, that's job security for me. It is hard being right all the time, but I'm getting pretty good at it, so I'll just continue on.
Yeah, it gets easier. I can give you some advice there. Yeah, I've been through that. But you don't find anything contradictory about that or disappointing or anything?
No, I think there is such a thing as truth. 2 + 2 = 4. It's not 4.1, it's not 3.99, it's 4. There is such a thing as absolute truth. And I think it's the same way when it comes to pleasing God. There's absolute mathematical truth. There's absolute truth of things that work with computers or mechanics or physics or biology. And so I think there are spiritual truths also. And I think most of them have been revealed to us through God's word. But how do we know truth? How do we know which religion is right? Well, Christianity claims to be the only way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. There's no entrance to the Father but by me. That's what he claimed. And I have chosen to believe that. I don't know what you believe, but that's what I'm believing.
Okay. We only have a few more minutes left. I have some general questions I'd like to ask you, just kind of current events and stuff.
Sure.
Do you know a guy named Robert Beatty? He says he's been trying to contact you, and he wants to see if you want to debate about like your prison sentence stuff. He believes that you are guilty, and you said that you're not guilty and all that. Are you interested in any of that?
I've never met him. He does some. He only had about 3 followers until he started picking on me. So I'm his claim to fame. I'm his sugar daddy, I guess. No, I'm not interested in talking to the guy. I don't think he's interested in truth at all on the topic. I've heard from reliable sources that he's an IRS agent and a plant, and is working for the government. So yeah, I'm not interested in talking to the guy.
Okay.
Other people have answered his criticisms many times.
Okay, another question. I'm not sure if you did you know your son Eric Hovind did a debate at Portland State University a few years ago with me? It's on YouTube.
My son has his own separate ministry and does a wonderful job. Yeah. I've not seen that debate with you that my son did, but no. Some of the questions you asked are actually more along the line of something he would deal with.
Well, I've noticed that he has a totally different tack than you do. I think that you like to talk about science, which I think is really good. I appreciate that. And I don't really appreciate Eric's standpoint. And I think he's just trying to play games philosophically. And let me ask you, he likes to repeat this thing from Satan Brugenkate. You know, like, for example, he says this, he has this one verse here, this assertion. He says, if you don't know everything, then you don't know anything unless you know somebody who does. Are you familiar with that?
I haven't heard that one. I'd have to chew on that one for a while. It sounds kind of complicated.
Oh, so do you know who Satan Brugenkate is?
I've never met him. I've read some of his stuff. He makes comments on websites, but I don't think I've ever met him.
Oh, okay. So basically, what they're trying to do is circumvent the whole argument about science, and they're just saying, hey, basically, it's like God exists because we wouldn't be here if he didn't, and end of story. So, you know, that's, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't follow those lines of logic very well. I'd have to have it explained to me a little simpler.
Okay.
I think we're here, so obviously some process made us, or some designer made us. That's like finding the watch on the beach, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Got a choice. Did the wave action do this, or the sunlight, or did some intelligent designer do it? Believe whatever you want.
I greatly do appreciate your approach to science, because personally I believe that I used to be a Christian, and I think I left because I learned more science, and I appreciate that you're bringing up science because all your followers are going to want to learn more science, and I think that's a good thing. You know, from
sure,
your perspective, you would think science proves God, which is great, so I think we both agree the more science the better.
Right, but you got to define science again. You know, evolution is not part of it, in my opinion.
Well, I mean,
it's been mixed in with our science.
Well, I'm saying science that we could both agree is just learning more about the world, learning more about reality. I think you would just say it should, you know, science should lead the God if science is correct.
I think it does. Just
right.
Studying the computer will lead to the conclusion, hey, somebody designed this. Let's talk, who was this guy?
Okay.
Who designed this ship, you know?
Well, thanks for calling in. We're out of time now, so I really appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Good talking to you.
All right.
Bye. Bye.